mighty, and thy grace will stand on your promises, and by faith we'll walk as you walk with us. Speak, O Lord, till your church is built and the earth is filled with your glory.
Come to the end of our time in James's letter. We have spent some time together as a church in the devotionals and in some sermons studying this letter. And this morning we're going to conclude it from James chapter 5, verses 7 to 11. Now, this is not James's conclusion to the letter, but it's one of the last ideas that he puts across in his letter. So we're going to spend our time in that this morning. James chapter 5 from verse 7 to 11. Therefore be patient, brethren, until the coming of the Lord. The farmer waits for the precious produce of the soil, being patient about it until it gets the early and the late rains. You too be patient, strengthening your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is near. Do not complain, brethren, against one another, so that you yourselves may not be judged. Behold, the judge is standing right at the door. As an example, brethren, of suffering and patience, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. We count those blessed who endured. You have heard of the endurance of Job and have seen the outcome of the Lord's dealings, that the Lord is full of compassion and is merciful. Well, what do you think is the virtue that is most required when we are going through suffering? As believers in the grace of God through Jesus Christ, what do you think is the foremost virtue that we must cultivate when we're faced with hard times, cruel times, times of uncertainty, when we are perhaps suffering injustice of any kind, or we're dealing with things that are really outside of our control and we're suffering because of it? What is the key virtue do you think Christians should be building and working on to cultivate? You might say that we should have faith in God, that we should steady our hearts and think that God is in control of everything, so we know that He is good, and so then we must place our faith in God and be steady in our faith. And you would probably be right. You might say that we need to cultivate self-control so that we don't respond in ways that dishonor God in the midst of suffering. If you said that, you would probably be right too. Still, another one of you might say that we must have hope in God, knowing that God is going to bring the end of all things and is going to bring joy to us at the end of all things. And so therefore, we must endure with hope in God. And even there, I'll think that you would still be right. James here proposes that the virtue we need is that of patience. And I want us to note that all of these other virtues, these three other virtues that I mentioned just now, faith in God, self-control, hope in what is to come, all of those find their neat seat in the idea of patience. They find their anchor in a heart that is full of patience. James has, in this section, just finished a section where he has been addressing the rich. In chapter 4 from verse 13, he addressed the rich merchants who boast in their future ability to make profits. And then at the beginning of chapter 5, he addresses the oppressive rich and essentially tells them that their riches are nothing and they will reap judgment for their oppressive behaviors. And it is in light of this address to the arrogant and the oppressive rich that James turns his attention back to those who are believers here in verse 7. Now, he last addressed the brothers, the Christians, back in verse 11 and 12 of chapter 4. He addressed the Christians in verse 11 and 12, chapter 4, and then he left the Christians and addressed these two groups, or whether it's one group, we're not sure, but he seems to address two other groups, and then now, in verse 7, he's coming back to address the brothers by calling them brothers here in verse 7. The question is raised, why does he address those two groups of the rich? Or if it's one group, we don't know. And what connection does verse 6 of James 5 have to verse 7? Well, here's some information. When taking into account James chapter 2, verse 6 to 7, where James says this, "But you have dishonored the poor man. Are not the rich the ones who oppress you and the ones who drag you into court? Are they not the ones who blaspheme the honorable name by which you were called?" And then, taking verse 6 into account of chapter 5, where he says, "You have condemned and murdered the righteous person," talking to the oppressive rich that he deals with in chapter 5, verses 1 to 6. Putting that information together and what we understand really about the context of James, it would seem that there were groups of rich people who were oppressing God's people in various ways, such that these people, these brothers here, the Christians, were living under sustained suffering from these rich people. And James takes the opportunity to give a lesson on what is required from a Christian when they are suffering. He's now dealt with the oppressors. He's now turning to the oppressed. And he's saying, this is what is required from a Christian when they are suffering. The lesson that James gives from verse 7 to 11 is a lesson on how to suffer well as a Christian. I must note for completeness that some argue that verse 12 is actually part of the same thinking, the same lot of thinking. And that's why in some of your Bibles, you see that verse 7 to 12 are grouped together. But there are actually good reasons to believe that verse 12 is the beginning of the end of the letter. So verse 12 begins a new idea, and it's really just a bunch of concluding remarks. When you read letters, normally what you'll find is that you'll find that there's some sort of concluding remark at the end to show that this is the, now I'm finishing what I'm talking about. But James doesn't have any of that except for that phrase in verse 12 where it says, "but above all." And we actually know from contemporaneous papers and letters that actually "but above all," that phrase was used to conclude letters. So verse 12 is actually is the beginning of a new thought. Verse 7 to 11 is where he's talking about this patience. So this lesson that's here from verse 7 to 11 is a lesson on how to suffer well. And it transcends the reason of suffering, okay? So this does not only apply to Christians who are suffering because of some rich people, like the Christians in James' time were, but rather this applies to all Christians at all times who are suffering. And the answer to how am I to suffer well is exercise patience. He says be patient, right? He uses it as a verb. Be patient. Do it. Exercise patience. Until when? When are you to be doing that action? Until the Lord Jesus returns. There is an action that I am to be doing constantly until Jesus returns, and that action is patience. And in telling us to be patient, James is going to first give us an illustration of patience. Second, he's going to give us the definition of patience. Third, he will give us a reason for patience. Fourth, he will show us what patience is not. And then finally, he will give us an example of patience. So let's first consider together the illustration that James gives of patience. And that is the illustration of the farmer. Look at verse 7. "Therefore, be patient, brethren, until the coming of the Lord. The farmer waits for the precious produce of the soil, being patient about it until it gets the early and the late rains. This is a fairly simple and straightforward illustration of what patience is. In many ways, it's so simple that it doesn't need any explanation. But it is worth noting a few things. Notice that this illustration says nothing about the effort that the farmer puts in when he's planting the crops. So sometimes when you hear about the farmer, because we're used to Paul and how he sometimes uses the analogy of a farmer, we immediately think about the energy that somebody puts in when they plant the crops. But that's not what he's talking about here. He says nothing about that here. James here only focuses on what the farmer cannot control, which is the rain that will cause growth on the crops. You see, because he cannot control when the rain will come, he must then wait. And in his waiting, the only thing he can do is to exercise patience. He has to be patient about it because he can't do anything about it. In the Hebrew mind, it is very clear that God is the one who brings rain. And James wants his hearers to focus their attention on that which only God can do. James says that patience has to do with waiting for what God will do, assured that God will do something. The rain will come. God will do something at the proper time. A patient person waits. There is a patience, dear saints, that is in vain, that is for nothing. Imagine, for example, if you were putting your money into a company, you were investing your money into a company, putting your money into this company, hoping that when you want to retire, when something will happen in the future, you'll be able to get a return out of that. But then in the midst of all of that, you've been patient, you've been doing this, you've been putting aside the money for a long time, and 20 years in, the company goes under. You see, and this is not hard to imagine. This has recently been happening in South Africa over the past couple of years. This is not hard to imagine. There is a patience that is in vain, where you might be patient, but there might not be any reward. There's nothing at the end of that patience. But here, James wants us to note that this patience that we're called to is not in vain. God will do something. There is a future event in which our patience will be rewarded. So then, in light of this, James then reiterates that we are to be patient like the farmer is in verse 8. You too, be patient, strengthen your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is near. That's our reward when he comes back. Now, here in verse 8, he gives more directly what he means by patience. He says, strengthen your hearts. In the ESV, it says, establish your hearts. The literal meaning of the word here is to take something and turn it resolutely, with resolve, in a certain direction. What James is saying here is that being patient is to grab a hold of our hearts with all strength and sternness and make them respond to the truth we know. And that truth is the Lord Jesus is coming. That is patience. That is true patience that Christians are called to. Where we grab a hold of our hearts and tell them to respond in line with the truth that there is a future event where all of this will have passed away. There's something real that happens to our hearts in times of uncertainty and hardship. I was reading an article on some of the key faults that managers of businesses fall into when the business is facing hard times. One of the faults that this author was arguing is that managers and businesses begin panicking instead of keeping focus. Listen to what this author argues. The panic response assumes that we better do something different to get through this. This assumption leads to a continuous eye on the next deal and an obsession with getting new customers or with new initiatives. This results in eroding customer service, missed low-cost new business opportunities with current customers, and the ship is adrift syndrome. The problem is that it is 5 times more expensive to obtain business from a new customer than it is from an existing customer. Also, employees really want clear direction, not a plethora of new initiatives during tough times. Focus is the alternative to panic. Focus assumes, let's keep doing what we do best. Leaders that respond with focus reinforce customer service and existing customer relationships and sustain their marketing efforts. Now, I'm not sure about this. Of course, I'm not a business guru, so I'm not sure if this is good business advice or not. So don't quote me on that. But I think as it relates to our hearts, we can relate to this concept. When we are in hard times, we are unsettled, and sometimes our emotions are all over the place. The solution is not panic. The solution is focus. Focus on what God will do. Steady our hearts and our emotions based on the solid reality of what God will do when our Lord, the captain of our salvation, appears. Right? We are to keep doing what we are meant to be doing. We are to not let stress and worry lead us into sin or lead us into thinking that we will be excused for sinning because we are stressed and we are worried. But we are to focus on the mission and remain patient. Keep steady. Follow the narrow path closely, even when we're hard-pressed. When James says, steady your hearts, we see that patience is not inaction. No, it's not without action. Patience is not grinning and bearing it. Patience is doing something, right? There's an action involved in patience. Listen to the Puritan Stephen Charnock as he explains. In regard of God, patience is a submission to his sovereignty. To endure a trial simply because we cannot avoid or resist it is not Christian patience. But to humbly submit because it is the will of God to inflict the trial, to be silent because the sovereignty of God orders it, is true godly patience. Burke Parsons puts it in modern English simpler when he says it this way. Unfortunately, many people think that patience is most predominantly demonstrated by someone who has an easygoing, laid-back attitude. But, on the contrary, patience is not some passive nuance of someone's character. It is an active, exhibited virtue. It is a virtue of trust. To exercise trust implies that we are trusting in someone greater than ourselves. It is no wonder that the world is so impatient. Those who do not know God can only trust in themselves, for there is no one greater in whom they can place their trust. Their confidence is self-confidence. Their esteem is self-esteem. And their reliance is self-reliance. If we trust in ourselves, then we are a hopeless people. But we are the people of God who place their trust in the sovereign creator and sustainer of all things. See, dear saints, on the one hand, patience is a joyful submission to the sovereignty of God. But on the other, it is an active pursuit of the will of God, even under trial. It must be noted, dear saints, that there is a way to suffer sinfully. Right? That's a concept that exists. Even if you are a true bona fide victim of some horrible sin and injustice, you are still required before God to obey His commands. Suffering does not give you a holiday from obedience. Instead, suffering requires obedience. It does the opposite. When suffering comes, it asks from you a new kind of obedience, right? And the command that we are to obey is that we are to suffer patiently, waiting for our vindication before God. We must know that if we suffer well, we will be rewarded. Patience recognizes that a trial is a gift from God to perfect us. James has already said this in chapter 1, verse 2. Remember, this is what he said in chapter 1, verse 2. Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. Did you notice that there's only one verb there? There's only one thing that you are to do. He didn't say pursue perfection. He didn't say pursue lacking nothing. He doesn't say any of that. He's saying one thing, and that one thing is count it joy when you are suffering, because the suffering is going to produce all these things that you want. So we must understand that there is a requirement on us to grab a hold of ourselves and even rejoice under trial. It is for this, and it is for this reason, that J.C. Ryle can say this: there is nothing which shows our ignorance so much as our impatience under trouble. We forget that every cross is a message from God and intended to do us good in the end. Trials are intended to make us think, to make us wean from the world, to wean us from the world, to send us to the Bible, to drive us to our knees. Health is a good thing, but sickness is far better if it leads us to God. Prosperity is a great mercy, but adversity is a greater one if it brings us to Christ. Anything is better than living in carelessness and dying in sin. You might not be going through a trial now. A lot of us are feeling the effects of this, but maybe some of us aren't. You might not be going through a trial right now, but every projection, it seems, that I'm reading is saying that the whole world at the moment is headed into some seriously hard economic times because of the virus. Some of us might lose our jobs because of all that's going on. Some of us are going to be squeezed even more as we take care of extended family. And some of you have been suffering under trials for a long time already, and this is just another trial to add on top of your many burdens. What James is encouraging us here, in light of what is coming and in light of what we're already starting to experience, is to steady our hearts and be patient. Is to consider what it looks like to suffer well, patiently under the sovereignty of God, knowing that the Son of Man will come on the clouds. I hope you notice in verse 7 and 8 that James equates the return of the Lord to the arrival of rains which bring good fruit. See, when he did that, that was on purpose. James is trying to remind us that when Jesus comes, all of our trouble is gone, all of our striving is gone, all of our patience is rewarded, and we will be vindicated before our God. Consider Revelation 22, verse 12. The Lord Jesus speaking, "Behold, I am coming quickly, and my reward is with me, and I will render to every man according to what he has done." But we must also consider that all over the scriptures we are called to action in light of the Lord's return. The writers of the New Testament see the reality of the coming of the Lord as weighty enough that it should elicit faithful living in us today. That the idea that Jesus is returning and the fact that that is a real thing that will happen should cause action on our parts. In Matthew, the Lord Jesus himself said, "So you must also be ready, because the Son of Man will come at an hour when you do not expect him. Therefore, keep watch." Peter says, "The end of all things is near. Therefore, be alert and of sober mind, so that you can pray." John says, "And now, dear children, continue in him, so that when he appears, we may be confident and unashamed before him at his coming." Hebrews chapter 10 says, "And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching." The day is approaching. That reality causes action. And James is here saying that action should be patience. We must not live as though the Lord Jesus isn't coming back. You know, it's possible to live in a manner, to say with your words that the Lord Jesus is coming back, but to live in as though that is not real. When you are buzzing and acting as though everything depends on what you do, and as if there's no grand plan, as if everything is just all over the place and it's chaotic, not being guided by the hand of a sovereign Father who's bringing everything to fruition. See, there is a way to live as though the Lord Jesus is not returning, as if the whole world is in chaos, without any kind of control by anybody, without any great reward at the end for his faithful people. Let us not break under trial, dear saints. Let us stand and steady our hearts. And if you feel that you have broken under trial, if you feel that that whatever trial that you're going through, or whatever hard time that you're going through, has broken you and has caused you to act in ways that are not steady, speak to someone. Start on the road, get some accountability. Start on the road to recovery. It is not too late to begin a life of patience. The Lord Jesus hasn't returned yet. There's still a lot of patience for you to exercise. Begin on the road toward recovery. Speak to someone. Get that sorted out. Make restitution wherever necessary. You are to exercise patience, and the Lord Jesus will not break a bruised reed. You are encouraged to repent and make and sort things out and come to Christ, and then go back to the narrow road walking in patience. Well, having shown us and told us what patience is, he now shows us what patience is not. Verse 9, "Do not grumble against one another, brothers, so that you may not be judged. Behold, the judge is standing at the door." One of the temptations in interpreting James's letter, because it reads so proverbially, is to take verses and make whole doctrines out of them without giving proper place to the surrounding context. We must remember, even though James has many one-liners that sound good on their own, James is not Proverbs. This is a letter. And this verse has been badly abused in history because the surrounding context had not been taken seriously. James says here, at the beginning of verse 9, he says literally, "Do not groan against each other." Some translations say, "Do not complain." Some of your translations will say, "Do not grumble." The idea is groaning that happens when someone is under pressure. Do not groan against each other. James is talking to our people who are suffering. And one of the things that is clearly a temptation when we are suffering is to complain and grumble. I do not think that I need to convince you of that, because you have seen how in a matter of a few weeks, all of a sudden, everyone is an epidemiologist and everyone understands how things should have been handled in whatever way. It's just there's a lot of thanklessness and a lot of complaining and grumbling. But the reality is we know why that's happening, right? Because people are uncertain, because people are feeling hard-pressed, that even the measures that are there to solve, people are seeing how it's affecting. People are losing jobs, but on the same hand, people are dying on the one hand as well. So it's just people are feeling the stress, and they're feeling the pressure, and it's hard. It's hard to keep a straight mind and a clear head when you are feeling under pressure and you're seeing your very livelihood on the line and the livelihoods of those you love. It's hard. But we must know, dear saints, that James is saying that God calls us to even while we're suffering, to not be people who let the pressure of the suffering explode in how we speak to one another, explode in grumblings and groanings against each other. Now, we must notice that James specifically says that we are not to grumble against one another, right? That's a specific groaning that he's speaking against, the one that spills out to other believers. And it is from this verse that some have argued that Christians should never correct each other and never find fault in each other because they are not to issue complaints against one another. And that's clearly not what James is talking about here. James is talking to a people who are suffering. I appreciate the scenario that John Calvin imagines as to what James is saying here when Calvin is trying to explain what James is talking about. Calvin imagines a group of Christians who are all under pressure. And because they're all under pressure, they end up sinning against each other. And James is saying, overlook the offense. Do not be quarrelsome against the brothers. Do not grumble against them, because even you yourself, you are guilty. And you will be judged if you judge others, if you grumble and groan against others as if to issue judgments on them when you're just speaking out of pressure. Let me quote Calvin. He says, "Be not querulous one against another, lest ye be condemned. We may indeed groan when any evil torments us, but James means an accusing groan, when one expostulates with the Lord against another, and he declares that thus they would all be condemned, because there is no one who does not offend his brethren and afford them an occasion of groaning. Now, if everyone complained, they would all have accused one another, for no one was so innocent that he did not do some harm to others." Another writer explains it in more easier to understand English this way: endeavor to always be patient of the faults and imperfections of others, for you have many faults and imperfections of your own that require forbearance. If you are not able to make yourself what you wish, how can you expect to mold someone else by your complaints and grumblings? And Jerry Bridges paints the picture more wholesomely here when he says this: patience does not ignore the provocations of others. It simply seeks to respond to them in a godly manner. It enables us to control our tempers when we are provoked and to seek to deal with the person and his provocation in a way that tends to heal relationships rather than aggravate problems. It seeks the ultimate good of the other individual rather than the immediate satisfaction of our own aroused emotions. See what James is going for? He wants us to be these patient people who, even though we are hard-pressed, we do not lash out against the brothers. We do not lash out against one another. Here's a practical question for self-reflection that I read somewhere. Who in your church agitates you? Be honest. With whom do you allow yourself to become angry and upset and irritable? Sort that out. Deal with that. Deal with whatever bitterness. Do not let a root of bitterness grow. Don't let groanings come because of whatever situation. Sort it out. We as God's people must be measured in all of our responses to each other, recognizing that the real judge of all of us is coming soon. But I want to draw your attention to something else in the second half of this letter, the fact that the judge is at the door and he's coming. That fact that he's coming soon is good news and bad news. It is good news for believers in Christ who have come to Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of their sins. They will have joy eternal. Even if some of their works do not go well, some of their works might burn, still they will have joy eternal because they are under the blood of the Lamb. They have been given a righteousness that is not their own, that stands even now because he is there and is alive. But notice that for hypocrites and the stubborn, there will be no joy. Those who persist in sin, those who persist in pursuing the way of death, those who do not confess their sins to God, those who do not humble themselves before Christ, it is not going to be a good day when the judge arrives. Earth and all of its troubles and all of its diseases and all of its economic trouble and problems and all of its strife that's here will look like a holiday for those people compared to what will happen to them. So let me encourage us, encourage anyone who might be watching this, that if you're not right with the Lord Jesus Christ, get right. If you're a hypocrite who's doing churchianity, get right with God. If you're a hypocrite who lives a life of grumbling against other people and you think that that grumbling doesn't judge you or you'll not be judged for it, get right with God. There is forgiveness that is found in the Lord Jesus Christ for all kinds of sins, grumbling or no. Every kind of sin can be forgiven if only you were to cry out to the Lord Jesus Christ and ask him to cleanse you. Do not persist in sin. Do not persist in self-deception. Do not think that your actions, that you can go around judging other people and then at the end, you will not be judged. No. No. Come to the Lord Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins so that when the judge appears, you will be right and safe with him. Finally here, James gives us an example of patience. He's shown us an illustration of patience. He's told us what patience is. He's told us what patience is not. Now he's showing us an example of patience. Verse 10. As an example of suffering and patience, brothers, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. Behold, we consider those blessed who remain steadfast. You have heard of the steadfastness of Job. You have seen the purpose of the Lord, how the Lord is compassionate and merciful. If you're struggling with patience, if you, as we were talking about this and we're thinking about this, and you know that perhaps you struggle with patience, or if perhaps you find that living in a time of uncertainty really brings out the worst in you, that your sins really come out when things are uncertain around you, I would think that it's a good idea for you to sit down with a cup of coffee or any beverage of your choice and open the Bible, particularly the Old Testament, and read stories of men and women who persevered and were patient and remained steadfast under severe suffering. That's what James is suggesting here. As an example, take the prophets, take them as an example and study them, look into them. James says that we consider them blessed, those who remain steadfast, and particularly Job, who is the quintessential man of patience. He's the quintessential picture of how to respond when you are hard-pressed from the top. Battered and bruised by death, disease, and poverty, Job did not grumble against God, but praised him. Battered and bruised, Job did not succumb to the temptation that said to him, curse God and die. Battered and bruised, he glorified God in a spirit of patience. He maintained his integrity before God. And what was his end? Well, God blessed him in the end. Job's final state of riches and children was more than before. Job was blessed way more, and the writer of Job makes it a point to let us know that his latter state was much better than the former state. It is the same for us. Whatever has been taken away, whatever loss you have suffered, whatever, when the Lord Jesus returns, He will make it seem like it was nothing. The riches of joy that await you at His right hand are absolutely incomparable. They are worth waiting patiently for. Samuel Rutherford was a Scottish Presbyterian minister in the 17th century, was acquainted with various sufferings. And he was imprisoned a number of times. His wife passed away. He knew what it is to suffer. But listen to this letter. He wrote a letter to a lady friend of his who had just lost her husband. And I want you to just focus on what James, what Samuel is calling out in this lady, what Samuel is trying to draw out in this lady. And may this attitude that he's trying to draw out be found in us as well. I'm going to read you a section from the letter. "See and consider then what you have lost and how little it is. Therefore, madam, let me entreat you in the bowels of Christ Jesus and by the comforts of His Spirit and your appearance before Him, let God and men and angels now see what is in you. The Lord hath pierced the vessel. It will be known whether there be in it wine or water. Let your faith and patience be seen, that it may be known that your only beloved, first and last, hath been Christ. And therefore now, where your whole love upon Him, He alone is a suitable object for your love and all the affections of your soul. God hath dried up one channel of your love by the removal of your husband. Let now that channel run upon Christ. Your Lord never thought this world's vain-painted glory a gift worthy of you, and therefore would not bestow it on you, because He is to provide you with a better portion. Let the movables go. Their true inheritance is yours. You are a child of the house, and joy is laid up for you. It is long in coming, but it's not the worse for that. I am now expecting to see, and that with joy and comfort, that which I hoped of you, since I knew you fully, even that you have laid such strength upon the Holy One of Israel that you defy troubles, and that your soul is a castle that may be besieged but cannot be taken. What have you to do here? This world never looked like a friend upon you. You owe it little love. It looked ever sourly upon you. However you should woo it, it will not match with you. And therefore, never seek warm fire under cold ice. This is not a field where your happiness grows. It is up above, where there are a great multitude which no man can number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, and standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands. What you could never get here, you shall find there. Consider how, in all of these trials, and I admit there have been many, your Lord hath been loosing you at the root from perishable things, and hunting after you to grip your soul. Madam, for the sake of Son of God's sake, let him not miss his grip, but stay and abide in the love of God, as Jude says." Oh, dear saints, may God help us to be found patiently waiting for His return, enduring steadfastness and the evils of this world. May we be found faithful on that day. They would not move this way or that way, but that we would seek Christ and seek Him completely until we see Him. May patience be found in each and every one of us, no matter what comes. Let's pray. Our dear Father in heaven, we do ask that you would work in us, change us, make us a patient people. Help us, Father, to respond like a people who know you, who know that you are good, who know that you are wonderful and that you actually are running the world. Help us to be a people who are patient, who have steady hearts, who think not of this world as home, but look where the Son of God is. Help us, Father, work in us, that you may find fruit in us, your tree. In Christ's name we pray all of these things. Amen. Well, may God's grace and peace be with you.